I am associated with Mandiram since its inception, actually. And that's why it's always a pleasure to be here. Today we'll be doing, it's like an interactive session. I would like your participation in the whole process. We are trying to understand two important aspects today. One is sensitivity and second is energetics. And both of them has a strong physics involved in it. I know it's a Sunday afternoon, but I would really like your senses to be on to understand this physics, because being an architect, I got a chance to learn physics in Germany, and these people have worked upon physical energies into a different realm, and their paradigm is totally above creativity, but it involves creativity into a physical sense. So I'll start with resisthesia first. Resisthesia, the word itself has a lot of twists, and it's a physics word, but not used. We don't use quite often in India, and not in it's also not an English word in per se. Germans and French scientists created it. So, do you recall any other word related to resisthesia which we use quite often? Or something sounds like resisthesia? Anesthesia, perfect. So what is anesthesia? So we'll start with that. Numbness, wonderful. One word is numbness. You become numb. Anything else? Senseless. Lose sensitivity. Sedative. So it's an artificial system where we are tuned or we are made numb, sedative, we lose sensitivity for certain time, you know, because our body is not used to that kind of numbness. Resisthesia is just opposite to it. Anesthesia stops or makes us feel numb or lose our sensitivity. Resisthesia is a science, it's a physics where we can learn how to increase our sensitivity, so that the feeling part, the internal body energetic part comes into life. We all have it, but we don't use it most. And it's not a phenomena which is often required in our day-to-day life, because we have tuned ourselves like that. Otherwise, in past, resisthesia or the sensitivity was the most important and major aspect of a human existence. So what I'll be doing is, my daughter Khushi is with me. She'll be speaking these words, which are the scientific words, and I will be then explaining or taking it forward paragraph by paragraph, because you guys can read it as well, because it's a very organized structure of words which have been put together into a very fine way by my teacher from Germany, and I don't want to replace it by using my own words, but we'll be discussing it or we'll be talking about it in so resisthesia is the science.
Resisthesia is the science of using vibrational fields of the human body to access information about other objects of animate or inanimate nature by establishing resonance with their energy fields using special instruments to decode the information.
So when we talk about resisthesia, we are talking about two major physical words along with it, but one is energy field and second is resonance. Energy field is the energy around us. Everything in this world has a vibratory field around it, and these vibrations are radiating. They are having a magnetic presence around us, and our body is tuned to feel it. And resonance happen, you know, everybody must have done a physics of Turing folk, when two objects have the same frequency or they are into the same wavelength, there is a resonance happening. So we are always 100%, 24/7, 365 days are resonating with something. Most of the time we don't know. Sometimes we know. So resisthesia is going to be talking or making us understand where are we actually having a resonance and which direction our energy fields are moving around.
The art was given the name resisthesia by French priest Alex Boli, derived from the Latin word radiation and perception.
You should underline the word priest. Why priest has to talk about it? Because radiation and perception was associated and still associated in some part of the world with religion. Because this is a perception which we think something from the external, you know, the cosmic vibration which is related to God or Almighty is coming. That's why priests were the people those days who were actually propagating this science, but not as a science, but as a paradigm of a God or something coming from the unknown intangible forces. That's why the priest was the discoverer of this particular science. But later it became a different subject.
In radiesthesia, our body is the main instrument, because what we are doing is entering into a vibrational relationship with the object. We are measuring and evaluating the quality of this interaction on our own body.
So end of the day, everything is you. Because when we are having resonance, we are utilizing all our energetic vibration and fields. So we have chakras, we have a specific vibratory body, and each chakra has its own illumination or vibratory field, which is energetic field. An individual body part is associated with each chakra, and these chakras are creating resonance with different people and objects around us.
The human spinal cord is like a wire with an electric current running through it. The electric impulses generate a detectable electromagnetic energy field around it.
So when what we talk as prana, we talk into a frontal lobe or front body, but in general it is from your spinal cord. It starts from your medulla oblongata and goes till the tailbone, and that is the radiating body, and that is where the prana is vibrating, and it has been created by God into a very strong shield. That's why it has not kept it in front, because this area is not vulnerable to defects or any other problems.
When two energy fields are in resonance, either by proximity, selective focusing, or any other method, they will modify each other, consequently affecting the current running through the central nervous system and its extensive nerve network that carries the impulses that controls all the body functions.
So this is quite clear that every part of the body is connected to this nerve. And this particular nervous system is having a current and radiating out to each organ. So every organ is associated with this nerve directly or vibrationally.
A sensitive person might feel an excess or depletion of energy, but has no way of measuring nor and evaluating the true quality of the relationship. Very much like driving a car that has no speedometer or indicator. We can use the car and feel if we are going fast or slow, but have no way of proper calculation for the exact evaluation.
So it's simple, you know, you are driving fast, you are too fast or you are too slow, but this slow and fast doesn't have a parameter or a specific numeric conditioning. Similarly, when whatever we are feeling, we say we are feeling good, we are feeling bad, but we don't know exactly what is good and what is bad and what are the range. Radiesthesia is a science which is going to help you determine that. Yeah, how much I am feeling good and how much I am going to be, how much I am feeling bad, or where is the cut point of good and bad.
Another important aspect that happens when two energy fields are in resonance is a type of information exchange on a vibrational level, where a DNA-like coded energetic signature of each is imprinted on the energy field of the other.
So normally we say that DNA is the energetic or genetic information of the body. But if you see different theories written by different people of biology and beliefs and, you know, the vibratory code, each and every cell inside the body has its own imprint. We have 50 trillion cells inside our body. And each cell has a direct communication with each other. That means we have a resonance inside our system as well. And if you are going to just impregnate or create a tuning of one cell, total cells, cellular microbiology of the body is getting changed or get affected. The similar way, DNA is the coded energetic signature which we have got from our parents. And this can be decoded easily through radiesthesia as well. Which pattern you are following.
Unfortunately, we have no senses that can perceive this information, even though it is in our energy field. This is very much like the radio and television waves that are all around us at a frequency beyond our perception. When we turn on the proper equipment, these energies become translated into visible images and audible sounds within our perpetual range of sensitivity.
Again, as I've already told you, we are not empowered to understand the quality of this vibratory field or energetics. We don't have any specific recording or digitizing system in our body. So our perception is either we are perceiving something, it is something like, you know, comprehension, which can be misapprehension also. So our brain is decoding certain information according to the references which we have kept in our brain.
Some people have the extrasensory ability to access this information. However, distortion usually occurs in the process of translation because what they perceive will be colored by their own experiences.
So experiences, information given in our childhood when we are into subconscious level, all the information or perceived and non-perceived, conscious and subconscious information are always stored in our brain. And a lot of time when we are trying to feel something, we have those references coming to us. So our feelings are mostly distorted, because when you touch somebody, you start taking a reference of the somebody else touch, because our brain has a memory which is stored with so much of information and which ignites and which becomes alive when you get the same reference again.
In the practice of radiesthesia, we are not bound by time and space. Initially, this might seem absurd, but if we remember that we are working on a vibrational level, not necessarily bound by the limitation of our physical senses. To illustrate this concept, let us examine what happens when we use the sense of hearing. Sound waves move the air and hit the eardrum, much as the wind hits a sail. Normally, the stronger the wave, the more pronounced is the reaction of the sail. In hearing, the mechanical effect of stronger sound waves hitting the surface of the eardrum results in our hearing louder sounds. However, there seems to be a process that enables us to selectively tune out or tune in to any type of wave regardless of its strength, to react to that specific wave and alter our perception accordingly. This is usually achieved by an act of will in the form of selective focusing.
So, when I'm speaking something, can you hear something ringing like a bell?
Outside.
Yes, this is what it's saying. So when I'm speaking, if you want to focus to me, focus to what I'm saying, you will ignore that, but subconsciously you'll still hear it. But if you don't want to focus to me and hear that, we can easily tune our brain and only hear that and not somebody speaking in front of you. Everybody must have experienced that. This is a very strong example of selective focusing, which is a major understanding of radiesthesia. And if you can tune this selective focusing through our brain, then you can hear something which is beyond our spectrum of hearing as well. And this is what animals do, because there are a lot of other sounds in this room which we cannot hear, because it is between 20 to 20,000 hertz what we can hear below, and after we cannot. So the sound is, the science is focusing, and the science itself is, the phenomena is governed by the brain and the activity in the brain.